You are listening to the Gamesmen PiXelTraX, the music trivia show that offers your favorite gaming currency.
Welcome one and all to the Gamesmen PiXelTraX, the show where you put your video game soundtrack knowledge to the test against your peers in order to win fantastic digital currency. I am your host, Steve Conger, also known as JSS Lifelike on basically every gaming service imaginable. So let me explain just how PiXelTraX works. Each episode, you, the listener, will be given 6 audio tracks from various software titles across a vast array of platforms. Every aural example will be accompanied by a verbal clue as well, and each correct answer is worth 1 point, thus making a pure perfect score for each show, a total of 6. But that's not all. Collectively, all of the tracks together will share a corresponding theme of sorts. Guessing the correct answer for what ties the music together is worth an additional 2 points. How do you submit your entry sheet, you ask? Send your numbered responses to thepixeltraxshow@gmail.com, and they will be tabulated as they arrive. And that's spelled thepixeltraxshow@gmail.com. Remember, if 2 or more entrants result in tie, it will be broken in order of arrival, so get your answers in early. Leaderboards will be kept at thegamesmen.com and will be accessible by clicking the tab above the main logo of the site. There will be a new PiXelTraX every other week, so you have less than 14 days to get your submission in, as the answers to this episode will be revealed the following time. The listener in first place at the end of every 3 months or 6 episodes will win a $20 card of their choosing, and the rankings will be reset. Sounds easy enough, right? Don't get complacent, though. There could be a bonus question where you'd least expect it. I've also decided to consolidate the Games in the Minigame audio articles into a short editorial to finish out each PiXelTraX installment. So let's get started. First, we'll reveal the answers to last show's queries. How many did you answer correctly? Let's see.
Selection number 1.
This game offered a series of online contests across North America, Europe, and Japan. Due to the violent acts depicted within, the German board refused to rate it at all. It has seen 3 different iterations, each of which landed on a different platform. You shouldn't need to stick your fingers down a woman's throat to get this one. Ninja Gaiden made use of the newest craze that was Xbox Live for competitions that literally included record-breaking numbers of participants. It was reworked and released in 2005 as Ninja Gaiden Black, and then again in 2006 for the PlayStation 3 with the surname Sigma. Then producer Tomonobu Itagaki was accused of sexual harassment by a fellow Tecmo employee, but was found innocent. Apparently, testing someone else's gag reflex is consensual.
Selection number 2.
This particular piece of software released in 2007, then was revived again in late 2010. It now exists on 6 different platforms and was the basis for official digital competition the world over. What game is it? Pac-Man Championship Edition was released on Xbox Live Arcade, Android, iOS, the Java platform J2ME, the PlayStation Network as a PSP Mini, and now on the Nintendo 3DS. The game's lead designer, Toru Iwatani, came up with the idea for the original game and called it Puckman. The name was later changed as it was all too close to a certain profanity.
Selection number 3.
This action-adventure platformer was released on the Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and PC, with a Mac OS version following 4 months later. It was heavily criticized for becoming too streamlined, but was equally praised for the digital performances and interactions between characters. Any guesses? ...2008's Prince of Persia featured a new take on the old mechanic of trial by death. Begrudgingly received by many, the continue or game over screen that one would normally see had been replaced with a magical last-minute grab by the player's companion, Elika. Played by Kerry Walgren, the character's interactions with the Nolan North-voiced Prince were easily the shining point of the experience.
Selection number 4.
This side-scrolling adventure game is widely considered to be one of the best gaming value propositions ever, unless you purchased it on the PC. It was developed by a now-defunct studio and also features a few top-down sections to shake up gameplay. Commando Rearmed, released in mid-August 2008, and was an incredible value on both XBLA and PSN at a mere $10. Apparently, comments and pressure from around the industry drove the price tag up 50% when released on the PC. It was a new take on the classic NES title, and the quality was revered so highly that developer Grin was given the opportunity to bring the series into three full dimensions. Not the greatest call in retrospect.
Selection number 5.
This first-person shooter utilizes the IW engine, which is actually just a modified version of the id Tech 3 engine. It is officially the best-selling FPS on its specific platform and will see a modified re-release in the days to come. What game is it? GoldenEye 007 for the Nintendo Wii was one of the key pillars in a last-ditch effort by Nintendo to prove to the gaming world that they had not forgotten their roots. Developed by Eurocom, who brought us the terrific Dead Space Extraction, the game was a spiritual remake of what could possibly be the Nintendo 64's most fan-followed title. It even outsold Ocarina of Time.
Selection number 6.
This game went a long way toward moving the franchise back to its roots. It achieves a constant 60 frames per second, which, in its exact genre, is a must-have bullet point for the back of the box. The Australian Customs and Border Protection Service lists the game as a prohibited item. Any guesses? 2011's Mortal Kombat, known as MK9, gave NetherRealm Studios and series co-creator Ed Boon a chance at a clean slate. Along with bringing back a good bit of what made the series great more than 15 years prior, the game saw critical success due in part to the resurgence of the fighting game genre by its closest competitor, Street Fighter IV. Copies discovered being imported into the country of Australia are to be seized and destroyed as they are considered a prohibited good. Those are last show's answers, but what do they all have in common? All of the aforementioned games are reboots. Each of these selected games draw heavily on established lore and mechanics, but offer a new look and or take on them. Sometimes they work, sometimes they go horribly wrong. Kind of like the difficulty curve for the episodes in Season 2. Yeah. Alright, let's get to this show's entries.
Selection number 1.
This sequel still employed a fair amount of gameplay from a three-quarter view, top-down perspective, but the majority transformed into side-scrolling action stages. Despite being rather disappointingly received critically, it has been documented as having gone on to sell over 4 million original units. Any guesses?